Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Court of Appeals. Please be seated. Thank you all for being here. So today, of course, is the day that we unveil the portrait of the Honorable Jonathan Lippman, who served so ably as Chief Judge of the Court of Appeals and of the State of New York from February 2009 through December 2015. Now, in a few moments, I will have the privilege of introducing a number of distinguished and very special guests who will be saying a few words in honor of Judge Lippman. But before I do so, there are a few introductions I would like to make, starting first with my colleagues on the court, Senior Associate Judge Jenny Rivera, Judge Leslie Stein, Judge Eugene Fahey, Judge Michael Garcia, and our newest judge, Judge Rowan Wilson. We have some formers in the house. I know that Judge Levine is attempting to get here. He hasn't arrived yet. We have Judge Carmen Beauchamp-Sukparik, Judge Vicki Graffio, and Judge Eugene Piggott. Thank you for being here, Judge. We have with us today our Lieutenant Governor, Kathy Hochul. Thank you, Lieutenant Governor. We have our Comptroller, the New York State Comptroller, Tom DiNapoli. Thank you for being here. We have our Solicitor General, Barbara Underwood. Thank you, Ms. Underwood. And we have local elected officials, statewide and local, starting with Mayor of the City of Albany, Kathy Sheehan, District Attorney Kate Hogan from Warren County, New York Senator Brad Hoyleman, and I know I saw Assemblywoman Helene Weinstein. Thank you for being here. From the judiciary, starting on with our federal colleagues, one of our favorites, Judge Colleen McMahon, the Chief Judge of the Southern District of New York. On the state side, starting with our Chief Administrative Judge, Lawrence Marks, our former Chief Administrative Judge, Gail Prudenti, serving now as the Interim Dean at Hofstra Law School. Presiding Justices of the Appellate Division, Randall Ang from the Second Department, Karen Peters from the Third Department, and their colleagues on the Appellate Bench. We have former Presiding Justices of the Appellate Division, starting with Betty Weinberg-Ellerin and Judge Luis Gonzalez. We have Deputy Chief Administrative Judge for the courts within New York City, Fern Fisher, and her colleagues on the trial bench, Acting Presiding Judge of the New York State Court of Appeals, Richard Seiss, and his colleagues from the trial bench, Chief of Policy and Planning, Judge Sherry Klein-Heitler, Chief of, Clerk of our New York State Court of Appeals, John Acello, the Attorney in Charge of the Legal Aid Society, Seymour James, Counsel to the New York State Commission on Judicial Nomination, Hank Greenberg. Thank you for being here, Mr. Greenberg. Dean of Albany Law School, Alicia Willett. Former Dean of Fordham Law School, John Ferrick. Chair of the Permanent Commission on Access to Justice, Helene Barnett. Our bar leadership from around the state, starting with Claire Gutekunst, who is the president of the New York State Bar Association, Ed Gersowitz, president of the New York State Trial Lawyers Association, and Betty Lugo, president of the Puerto Rican Bar Association. And of course, there are other special guests, family, friends, and a little artistic talent who I'm sure will be mentioned as the program proceeds. So, on this occasion, in this beautiful building, which, by the way, celebrates its 100th anniversary this year as home of the New York's highest court, in this, and I think you'll all agree, absolutely magnificent courtroom, built, by the way, at a different location in 1884 and transported and reassembled piece by piece in this location. I think it's impossible not to feel humbled by our court's history, and that history, I think, is so beautifully portrayed in the many iconic portraits of the judges who presided in this courtroom, starting with a few mentionables: John Jay, who is behind me, before you, Benjamin Cardozo, Judge Breitel, and of course, Chief Judge Judith Kaye, each of whom contributed so mightily to our judicial excellence here in this court. And of course, joining their ranks today is our much admired friend and colleague and former leader, Jonathan Lippman, whose humble and modest beginnings serve only to underscore his remarkable ascent to the highest judicial position in our state. A true success story, accomplished because of his legendary work ethic, his brilliant mind, his strong leadership skills, tireless and energetic pursuit of justice, and his absolute devotion and commitment and love for our courts. It's not my role today to dwell on Judge Lippman's storied career as a bold leader and reformer of our courts, or on the influential body of jurisprudence he so carefully crafted over his term here, but I cannot resist the temptation to publicly acknowledge Judge Lippman's most enduring legacy, his commitment to closing the access to justice gap in our state and to balancing the scales of justice so that every person, no matter his or her station in life, can stand equal before the law. In light of his many significant contributions to the administration of justice in our state and across the country, it is only fitting that we gather here today in his honor to unveil his portrait, which shall forever, forever hang in this magnificent courtroom to remind us all of the legacy of a wonderful colleague and a most faithful public servant. So now, to start the program formally, it is my pleasure to introduce our first speaker, the Honorable E. Leo Malonis, presently a member of the law firm of Pillsbury Winthrop, and a former everything, former chief administrative judge, associate judge of the appellate division, city bar president, mentor to many, and an absolute lion of the bar. Judge Thank Malonis. You.
I also do the laundry, I can cook, I do a lot of things. Well, I want to thank Chief Judge DeFiore and the court for hosting and maintaining this important tradition. This is such a wonderful way for all of us to celebrate Judge Lippman's spectacular career. I have with difficulty tried to spare you the portrait hanging jokes, but bear with me. I like to thank Chief Judge DeFiore for keeping up the custom of the new Chief Judge publicly hanging her predecessor. And Judge Lippman, you really deserve to hang around with the likes of Cardozo, Lehman, Fuld, and Kaye. As you would say, it's terrific. Speaking of Judge Kaye, actually, I am hanging as a former city bar president of the city bar. And I'm what the past presidents called a former living. The portrait was painted by a very good friend, Gianberto Vanni, and who unfortunately was not a portrait painter. He was an abstract painter. At my hanging, Judge Kaye, who had a great voice and beautiful handwriting but really couldn't paint, said, Leo, you should have let me do it. I could have done a much better job. And Ann Fowle, the former chief administrative judge, said to me in a menacing way, I know that look. I've seen that look. And George Roberts, who some of us know, who was didn't really sit on himself too much, said that, Leo, someday you may look that old. Well, Giamberto obviously was a visionary painter because it seems that the day has finally come. And as far as Judge Lippman and Mr. Green are concerned, I've had a sneak peek, and I can only tell you the portrait is truly majestic. I have known Judge Lippman for about a quarter of a century. We worked closely together in court administration, and we've been very good friends ever since. We've worked in difficult times and sometimes with very difficult people, but somehow we made a dent, and largely because of Judge Lippman, we really always enjoyed ourselves. Over the years, as his responsibilities expanded, Judge Lippman has not changed, and I want to thank Amy for that. His career has been, in fact, historic. Judge Lippman is the only person in the history of our courts to hold the three most important court positions. He was the chief administrative judge while working with Judge Kaye for 11 years, and together they made our courts the most innovative in the nation, and the reforms have been the model and have been copied by many other states. He was then presiding justice of the Appellate Division First Department, arguably the leading intermediate appellate court, but the First Department handles some of the most complex commercial cases in the nation. And in a short time, he improved many of the court's systemic problems. He tremendously improved morale, and he cleared up the backlog and made the caseloads current and up to date. And why we are here today, he became chief judge of this court, the greatest court in the nation, bar none, period. In this position, in his writings and programs, Judge Lippman gave wings to his heartfelt values and passions. To provide fairness, access, and affordable justice to our citizens. And because of this court, the laws of New York are referred to as the gold standard, preferred as the law to interpret and enforce complex commercial agreements, not only in American contracts, but overseas in contracts involving a business worldwide. Now we have the next chapter of Judge Lippman's extraordinary career. He has counseled to Latham & Watkins, a premier law firm. Yet somehow, Judge Lippman still finds the energy and the time to serve the public. And I hope you've all seen today's editorial of the Times. If you haven't, I'll just read an excerpt from you. And this is about the Rikers Island business that Judge Lippman chaired. The commission was just issued a report on Rikers Island. The credit for a real Rikers roadmap must go instead of the mayor, the state's former chief judge, Judge Lippman, who has spent the last year heading a commission to examine the city's criminal justice system. His report on Rikers Island, which was to be released on Sunday, makes a forceful case for how and why to shut down Rikers. It would move inmates to one jail in each borough, each with a capacity proportional to the borough's share of inmates. The jail would be in downtown areas attached to or near county courthouses. Jails that already exist would be modernized and expanded, or new ones would be built on existing footprints. It's a specific, sensible, defensible plan. It saves money and spreads the burden. And what we don't, I think, appreciate is the fact that the possibilities, this vast parcel of land, it's almost like having another borough, an open borough, office of the city. For example, it could become another Silicon Valley within the city, bringing new industry, housing, schools, jobs, commerce, all of which will more than pay for Rikers Island. Now, how did Judge Lippman do all of this? Well, he's certainly very smart, certainly very wise. But I think what makes Judge Lippman stand out is the strength of his character, his enthusiasm, his sincerity, his tremendous optimistic energy, and especially the infectious joy and passion he brings to everything he does. Looking at this impressive portrait soon, and reflecting on Judge Lippman's extraordinary life and achievements, to sum it up by using an eloquent phrase coined by a former chief judge, not too shabby. Thank you.
Thank you, Judge. Our next speaker is Jim Sandman, former managing partner at Arnold & Porter and currently, with his hands full, the president of the Legal Services Corporation, our nation's largest funder of civil legal aid for low-income Americans. Mr. Sandman is a natural to speak about our former chief, as Jim has devoted so much of his career to ensuring that our legal system functions in a way that guarantees equal access to justice for all Americans. Ladies and gentlemen, I present Mr. Sandman.
Justice Sotomayor, Chief Judge DeFiore, Chief Judge Lippman, other judges, guests, good afternoon. In the 7 years he served as Chief Judge of the State of New York, no person in America did more to improve access to justice than Jonathan Lippman. Because of him, New York today leads the nation in the creativity, comprehensiveness, and resources it brings to the mission of making its courts accessible to people who cannot afford a lawyer. I think there are three reasons for Chief Judge Lippman's extraordinary effectiveness and success. First, he had the insight to recognize the justice gap for the crisis that it is. And he determined to pursue solutions commensurate with the magnitude of the problem. When he became Chief Judge, he saw that more than 93% of low-income New Yorkers were proceeding in civil matters without a lawyer. 2,300,000 New Yorkers every year in court alone. He regarded that as a breach of our nation's solemn pledge of justice for all and of our founders' imperatives. Thomas Jefferson, he liked to point out, said, "The most sacred of the duties of government is to provide equal and impartial justice to all its citizens." He didn't believe that you attack a crisis in baby steps. And so he thought big, really big. The second reason he was so effective was because he demonstrated unparalleled leadership. He did what a leader does. He took responsibility for the problem, personal and institutional responsibility. He thought the judiciary and he himself as chief judge had a particular role to play in improving the situation. "There is no institution," he said, "to which equal justice is more important than the judiciary. If we do not speak up, how can we expect others to?" And so he used the power and the prestige of his position to call attention to the issue and to pursue necessary change. But like any great leader, he didn't do it alone. He recruited and enlisted allies, new allies, the executive branch, the legislative branch, business leaders, religious leaders, community leaders, because access to justice is a societal issue. It's about the rule of law. It affects us all. And third, Chief Judge Lippman was always acutely aware of and motivated by the human consequences of the justice gap. This was not just some abstract principle to him. The problem affects real people, our fellow citizens. His voice would break when he spoke of the stakes for people trying to navigate our court system on their own. The roof over their heads, their personal safety, their livelihoods, the well-being of their families. His empathy fueled his passion. As a result of this combination of thinking big and leadership and passion, he racked up an astonishing set of accomplishments. For example, when he became Chief Judge in 2009, New York was dedicating state funds of less than $20 million to the provision of legal services. Today, that number stands at $100 million. He drove a revolution in pro bono to bring additional resources to bear on attacking the problem. He instituted the 50-hour requirement, 50 hours of pro bono work for admission to the bar, and the Pro Bono Scholars Program and the Attorney Emeritus Program. He made it possible for in-house corporate lawyers who were not members of the New York Bar to do pro bono work. And he required mandatory reporting of pro bono hours so that there could be a measure of the pro bono resources being brought to bear on the problem. He pushed for simplification of court forms, and he made it easier for non-lawyers to assist people who do not have access to a lawyer. Through programs like Legal Hand, the Storefront Program in New York, and the Court Navigator Program and Housing Court in New York City, led so ably by Justice Fern Fisher, who is here today. He promoted the expanded use of mediation and alternative dispute resolution, and the increased use of technology to reach people who can't afford a lawyer. You don't attack a crisis in small steps. He thought big, and he achieved big. The portrait to be unveiled here today is a picture of a hero of justice. May it be an inspiration to the judges and lawyers of New York for generations to come, and may it be a reminder to all New Yorkers that the Empire State will stand second to none and its commitment to making equal justice a reality for every one of its citizens. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. Our next speaker is Professor Vincent Bonventri, who is the Justice Robert H. Jackson Distinguished Professor of Law at Albany Law School. Professor Bonventri is without doubt the foremost scholar on the workings and jurisprudence of the New York Court of Appeals. His familiarity with our court dates back to his days here in this courthouse as a clerk to both judges Matthew Jason and Stuart Hancock. Professor Bonventri has written many insightful law review articles and short essays analyzing Judge Lippman's opinions and the impact of his jurisprudence and leadership. Professor?
It's always such a thrill to be in this courtroom. Chief Judge DeFiore, associate judges, and former associate judges of this honorable and great court. And it is especially thrilling to be here today to share a few reflections about the honorable and great Chief Judge Jonathan Lippman. Years ago, as a judicial fellow for Chief Justice Warren Berger, I was asked to make a few remarks at the end of the fellowship year. Among other things, I said that I revered the New York Court of Appeals at least as much as I did the Supreme Court. Fortunately, William Rehnquist, who by that time was appointed Chief Justice, he chuckled out loud because he knew that that's the way I had felt. Otherwise, it would have been quite awkward. And I do revere this court because of its rich history of decisional law, and in large measure because of the leadership of extraordinary chief judges, such as Jonathan Lippman. For example, there is Chief Judge Robert Earl right here in the corner. He's the one who's bald with a beard. And Chief Judge DeFiore has promised me that his portrait will never leave. Early in the court's history, many of his decisions actually laid foundation for the law of New York and for the nation. So, for example, in In re Jacobs, he pronounced the then radical but still debated proposition that constitutional liberty is more than mere freedom from imprisonment or other physical restraint. Like the opinions of Chief Judge Earl, one of the hallmarks of Chief Judge Lippman's decisions are their boldness and their forward reach. And that is why he did not discourage dissenting opinions that underscored their very boldness and the reach of his opinions. Then, of course, there is Chief Judge Benjamin Cardozo. The overreaching character of his jurisprudence, which he was not reluctant to express, was the notion that judicial decisions should, in his own words, be consistent with the sense of justice and with the social welfare. And he also argued, a Constitution's guarantees are not rules fixed in the past, but are principles for an expanding future. Boy, he'd have a rough time with the Senate right now. So too, like Chief Judge Cardozo, Jonathan Lippman's jurisprudence was certainly not a dedication to some avowed interpretive methodology, but rather a commitment to the policy consequences of his decisions, that they should advance justice and social betterment. Chief Judge Stanley Fuld's decisions on the rights of the accused influenced constitutional law throughout the nation, and in fact were relied upon in many of the Supreme Court's landmark rulings during the era of Chief Justice Earl Warren. Similarly, Chief Judge Lippman's opinions have had impact beyond this court and this state. Chief justices from states around the country have volunteered to me that with Jonathan Lippman as chief judge, they were again paying close attention to the decisions of the Court of Appeals, and they were looking to him for leadership. Chief Judge Lawrence Cook's tenure coincided with the significant retrenchment by the Supreme Court from many of its rights-protective landmarks of the Warren era. Chief Judge Cook understood well that the New York Court of Appeals was not merely an intermediate court in the federal judiciary, and that it certainly need not follow in lockstep with the Supreme Court. I'm sure Justice Sotomayor would agree with that. Instead, he continued to advance protections of civil liberties and criminal rights under New York's own constitutional law. Likewise, Chief Judge Lippman's opinions in so many areas, search and seizure, personal privacy, right to counsel, interrogation, do not merely follow federal doctrines that would dilute constitutional protections, but instead they rely upon and set independent precedents. Then, of course, there is Chief Judge Lippman's immediate predecessor, our beloved Judith Kaye. More than anyone else in the modern history of this great court, she studied the role of state courts in our federal system, and she pressed upon her colleagues the obligation to enforce rights and liberties under this court's own constitutional case law. So, too, Chief Judge Lippman's opinions evince that same understanding, obligation, and purpose to advance the protections of this court's own precedents and not being tied to narrower, less protective rulings of the Supreme Court. There are, to be sure, other extraordinary chief judges in this court's history who have made a considerable impact in moving the law forward. Cuthbert Pound, Irving Lehman, Charles Desmond, Saul Wachler, among others. As for Chief Judge Lippman, he stands out in that lineage as one of the most extraordinary of them all. Finally, when Chief Judge Jonathan Lippman's portrait is hung right up there, I believe, facing those judges of this court as they sit on the bench behind me, it will be saying to them, do not forget what has made this court great. Do not forget the great heritage of this court's leadership in this state and throughout the nation. I personally am certain that history itself will not forget how the judicial decisions of Chief Judge Jonathan Lippman as well as his leadership in the center seat, which is now proudly occupied by Chief Judge Janet DeFiore, that his judicial decisions and his leadership have advanced what has been greatest about this court. History will not forget the truly extraordinary contributions and impact of Jonathan Lippman as Chief Judge of this truly great court. Thank you, Chief Judge Lippman, and thank you all very much.
Thank you, Professor. And now we'll hear from Jamie Wong. Jamie is the chair of the Global Litigation and Trial Department at Latham & Watkins, where she oversees 600 lawyers in 21 offices around the world, including a young lawyer there named Jonathan Lippman.
Good afternoon. It's a real honor to be here today among this extraordinary group and in these beautiful settings. And I just wanted to say, Judge, it's especially gratifying to have you sitting right here while I give these remarks because being a one who follows Jewish traditions, I'm not accustomed to being at an unveiling where the one we're honoring is alive and in attendance. So this is a nice treat for me. We at Latham & Watkins are so fortunate that Judge Lippman chose to practice with us. After an exceptional four-decade career in the courts, where, as you all know, he was a champion of the underserved and those most in need, Judge Lippman is continuing that pursuit with the same fervor and zeal. One of my Latham colleagues noted to me that Judge Lippman is exceptionally effective at making his case in a way that is relatable to everyone and alienates no one. And as we've heard, this is exemplified in the way he talks about access to justice as ensuring that all people have meaningful representation when their liberty or the very necessities of life are at stake. He draws a sharp picture of how our court system directly intersects with people's fights for these necessities of life. He talks about fighting for a roof over their heads rather than generically talking about landlord-tenant law. He talks about fighting for their physical safety rather than just referencing the criminal justice system. And he talks about fighting for the well-being of their families, thus underscoring the need to improve the state of our family courts. And he worries out loud that underserved people literally can fall off the cliff without legal representation helping them fight these battles about the very essentials of life. Judge Lippman doesn't just make these issues relatable, he strikes a chord in us as human beings. Judge Lippman's passion and unparalleled commitment to pro bono is truly inspiring to all of us at Latham, where pro bono work is a core value of our institution. What Judge Lippman has done, consistent with his style and his unique gift, is make the commitment to pro bono even more relatable to each one of us. As one of my partners described, Judge Lippman has made us realize that commitment to pro bono should not just be an obligation or a good thing to do, but essential to our identities as professionals, as citizens of New York, and as human beings. This, of course, is reflected in the judge's work and the various reforms that he pushed through while in the courts. Our firm invested approximately 180,000 pro bono hours last year, but none more important than the work we were privileged to do on behalf of the Rikers Commission, Judge Lippman's most significant project since leaving the bench. With the release of the report this weekend and the mayor's endorsement of its central recommendation, we are all supremely proud of what the judge has accomplished. Throughout his career, the judge has spoken about needing both vision and action, innovation and energy, in order to effect change, and we have seen that on display once again. When first tasked with this responsibility, in his results-oriented and get-things-done style, he promised to pull no punches, and simply to recommend what was right and fair and best for the city. Only Judge Lippman could have pulled this off. Okay, so now for some fun stuff. I asked some of my colleagues at Latham about Judge Lippman, and what I realized, which really was not a surprise at all, was how much he has impacted a group of big law professionals in the little over the year he's been in our firm. My colleagues described learning from Judge Lippman to be bold and to set ambitious goals, but also to be pragmatic, patient, thoughtful, deliberate. What I heard most is how inspiring Judge Lippman is. Many noted his unfailing humility, his unwavering integrity, his generosity of spirit, and his amazing energy. He truly relishes what he does, and he has a fantastic sense of humor to go along with it all. My colleagues also described him as a keen observer of others, candid and humorous, but never mean-spirited. One of my favorite reports came from one of my partners who said, "I've never heard him say a bad thing about anyone, but if he does make a less than complimentary statement about someone, he always caveats it by saying, and I mean that in the best possible sense." One of our partners described the judge as having a cool and laid-back style. Now, that might be surprising to some of you, but I can attest to it. In May of last year, I had the pleasure of spending a few days in London with Judge Lippman and his wonderful wife, Amy. He gave a talk at the Royal Court of Justice, speaking as he's done frequently over the last year in the UK and throughout Europe and elsewhere, about the importance of access to justice and various judicial reforms. Now, I'm going to digress here just for a moment about this visit. Prior to the talk, the judge and our small group who were lucky enough to be traveling with him were given a behind-the-scenes tour of the Harry Potter-esque royal court by the Lord Chief Justice himself. Talk about access to justice. I mean, that's what we learned. Though I have to say, Judge Lippman did become a little disappointed in wondering why, when he was New York's top judge, he was called only Chief and not Lord Chief. But back to the cool, laid-back Judge Lippman. Among the highlights of the trip was the next evening, after attending a long event with little food, the judge led our group to a chic London restaurant at nearly midnight. After we convinced the host to seat us for dinner, Judge Lippman ordered bottles of champagne, the start of a leisurely and very entertaining late-night meal. And only later, when we were back in the States, did we learn, and not through him, that it was his birthday that evening. Classic Judge Lippman. We are all blessed to know Judge Lippman and to cherish all that he does. We look forward to working with him for many years to come and are so proud and honored to be part of this very special occasion. Thank you, Judge.
Thank you, Jamie. And now, Mary Campbell McQueen, our fabulous president of the National Center for State Courts, longtime colleague, friend, and partner of Judge Lippman's as they worked together for many, many, many years in pursuit of their shared passion for court reform and access to justice. Mary?
Madam Chief Judge, Justice Sotomayor. Larry, I should have asked for an interpreter. I just realized that my southern accent may require that I speak more slowly. And I understand the artist is here today. Is Mr. Green?
Right there, second row.
Aristotle tells us that the aim of a portrait is to capture the inner significance of the subject. That the only expression allowable in a great portrait is the expression of character and moral quality. Nothing temporary, fleeting, or accidental. The artist looks for that one facial expression that captures their sitter's essence, that creates an artistic autobiography. The story of a person on canvas. So portraits like the law reflect significant events, places, personalities, not in words, but in images. And today we gather to celebrate the life work, the contributions of former Chief Judge Jonathan Lippman, to memorialize his character, his moral qualities, and his contribution to the law and judicial administration. Through Daniel Green's artistic autobiography, Judge Lippman's official portrait. So having worked, played, and yes, debated with Judge Lippman for over 30 years, beginning our careers as state court administrators in New York and Washington State, I was anxious to see how Mr. Green would capture that essence that is Jonathan Lippman, the judge, the leader, the man, and the friend. Would Mr. Green be able to capture that kind of hint of a smile that Judge Lippman reveals when he reminds the other state chief justice of the unique title belonging to the highest judicial position in New York by saying, "Remember, there is no justice in New York." Or the way that he slightly nods his head and rubs his chin, indicating his genuine interest in your conversation, his eyes never straying while he engages you in one of his favorite subjects, the courts. Would his portrait reflect his courage and determination in a face-on frontal position or another so familiar to colleagues? How would this likeness capture the strength of his leadership, reminding us that, like another chief judge, Benjamin Cardozo, Chief Judge Lippman also agreed that membership in the bar is a privilege burdened with conditions. For Judge Lippman, one of those conditions linked the practice of law with pro bono service. So how would Mr. Green accurately capture the source of the light that influences Judge Lippman's well-reasoned opinions? Will it shine from the left or from the right? Well, a glance will reveal to us, and maybe while it was slightly over his left shoulder, it's going to be definitely from the center. Will the background in the portrait include glimpses from his daily life, perhaps a stack of bound opinions, pictures of his family, or a glimpse of buildings housing the other branches of government through a well-placed window, reflecting those hard-won battles for judicial compensation and preservation of judicial independence? Will we see evidence of his national and international influence, not only in developing the law of New York, but in creating a process for our nation's state court administrators to advance the administration of justice through over 25 years of well-reasoned, evidence-based policy papers, ranging on issues from problem-solving courts to pretrial release, the ending of debtor courts to advancing racial and ethnic fairness, and advancing transparency in the courts by balancing privacy and public access to court records in this new generation of e-everything. How would Mr. Green depict the compassion and dedication of service sculpted by Judge Lippman's hands? Would his hands depict that strength of purpose when he hosted our nation's first summit on human trafficking? Or that relaxed confidence of a man that knows his calling? Perhaps a tightened grip reflecting his courage and the purpose behind the closure of Rikers Island. To Judge Lippman, a moral imperative. And how could a portrait ever capture the scrutiny, the lifelong curiosity, the sincerity and dedication mirrored in Judge Lippman's arched eyebrow or occasional playful wink? How will generations of viewers grasp that passion? The intensity of his eyes, that gaze, or the set of his determined jaw? And the portrait must also incorporate the familiar laugh and worry lines of Amy's Johnny, the father of Russell and Lindsay, and patriarch of a family of four attorneys. Will we see Amy's inspiration, support, and touch of class in a carefully chosen tie, not too gaudy, or in the relaxed countenance of a man well loved? Mr. Green, today we celebrate your artistic autobiography depicting the life of a good judge, your portrait of Jonathan Lippman. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary. And now it is my great honor to introduce our central speaker, the Honorable Sonia Sotomayor, Associate Justice of the Supreme Court of the United States. It is by every measure a special and historic day for all of us to have in our midst, here at the Court of Appeals, a justice of the highest court in the land. And it is especially so because it is Justice Sotomayor, a New Yorker through and through, one of our nation's leading public figures, and a woman for whom we all feel such great pride and affection. Now, we've all heard the wonderful, inspirational life story of Justice Sotomayor, the daughter of humble, hardworking Puerto Rican parents who grew up in public housing in the South Bronx, her dad, a factory worker, passing away at a young age, her strong, self-sacrificing mother studying English alongside her daughter to become a registered nurse, always working and striving for excellence in her academic career, attending parochial school in the Bronx, graduating as valedictorian of Spelman High School, going on to Princeton on a full scholarship, and then to Yale Law School, where she was, surprise, surprise, editor of the Yale Law Journal. And of course, her remarkable legal career, starting with her first professional experience, distinguishing herself as a firm and fair prosecutor in the New York County District Attorney's Office under the legendary Bob Morgenthau, then becoming a successful litigator, specializing in intellectual property, and on to the federal bench with her appointment in 1991 by then President George H.W. Bush, her elevation to the Second Circuit in 1997, and then, of course, in May 2009, President Obama nominated Justice Sotomayor to serve on our nation's highest court. Officially sworn in on August 8, 2009, Justice Sotomayor became the first Latina Supreme Court justice in American history, and she has carried forward the great tradition of the many, many legendary lawyers and judges, including several pictured around this courtroom, who have served on the Supreme Court of the United States with great distinction and integrity. I think everyone in this room will agree with me when I say that Justice Sotomayor has brought to the court's deliberations and jurisprudence a unique blend of personal and professional experience, skill and personality, and she has certainly impacted the court with her brilliant mind, deep wisdom, legendary work ethic, and her characteristic open-mindedness and genuine desire to understand differing views and positions. Justice Sotomayor is surely someone who, as she's described herself, strives to build bridges instead of walls. But anyone who follows her work on the court also knows that she is no pushover. She is strong and independent, and her insistence on equal justice for all Americans, regardless of background, is simply uncompromising. We are so grateful and honored that Justice Sotomayor has joined us today to offer special remarks in recognition of her friend Jonathan Lippman and his extraordinary contribution to the courts and our system of justice. Ladies and gentlemen, Justice Sotomayor.
It is always so good to be back home again and among so many people and friends that I cherish. Madam Chief Justice, I concur fully in the opinions of the other speakers about the importance of this court, full stop. And about the greatness of the man that's being celebrated today, Jonathan Lippman. I have known Jonathan virtually my entire judicial career, which this coming fall will be 25 years long. And that's only a fraction of Jonathan's. From the start and all of the time since, Jonathan has been one of the most positive people I have ever met. His warm, generously open greetings are always infectious. His optimistic attitude about life and about the good things we accomplish if we just try are legendary. He has referred to his work in the New York State court systems as attempts to move mountains. He hasn't just moved them. He's displaced them from one place to another, and yet another. He has chosen to be a mountain mover because he genuinely believes that state courts are the laboratories of justice. And he has spent virtually his entire life proving that his belief is correct. Jonathan obviously knows the topography of the mountain he is trying to move, the New York State court system, because of his lifetime of service. He started as a legal assistant in the state Supreme Court and worked his way up the administrative side of the court for his first 20 years of service. After that, Jonathan worked his way up the judicial side of the courts for another 20 plus years, ending up as the chief judge of this magnificent court. By that time, he had amassed more knowledge of the pathways and nooks and crannies of his state court system than almost anyone else. But what Jonathan possesses above all is his explorer's vision. You have heard the speakers today and their detailed descriptions of the many new and innovative paths he has helped forge. From the neighborhood and other problem-solving courts he has helped establish, to the pro bono service requirements of the New York Bar members he has helped institute, to the non-lawyer navigators he has employed to assist in housing and debt courts, and to the wrongful conviction task force he helped to create to collect and share data on wrongful conditions. Jonathan has infused each enterprise with his boundless energy and his passion for doing justice. New York is so fortunate to have had Chief Judge Jonathan Lippman's knowledge and vision guiding it. I know that Jonathan's contributions will not end with his retirement. We've just heard about a report that I haven't read yet, but I will, on Rikers Island. Although some might feel that his retirement came too soon, maybe 15 years too soon, Jonathan? He is the rare judge in our judicial system, state and federal courts alike, who can retire knowing that his tireless efforts have made a difference on a mountainous scale. The reforms he championed and the decisions he authored have changed the lives of so many people, and just as importantly, have changed the way that so many others view our justice system. His life work is a reminder that there are always new mountains to move and that the work of justice is never done. Jonathan, my friend, you should leave this position knowing how treasured you are by so many, and how inspirational your service will be for so many others to come. My friend, I thank you for a job so very well done.
So now, for the unveiling. Amy, we invite you up. Jonathan, Chief Judge. Person we've all waited to hear from, our former Chief Judge, the Honorable Jonathan Lippman.
Well, I will be brief. Because it's all been said much better than I could say it, and much more complimentary than I deserve. And what a great day it is, and how honored I am. I've had a lifetime in the courts and the pursuit of justice to be thankful for. But today, in this majestic courtroom, this really caps it off. First, let me say, after seeing Churchill's reaction, I don't know how many of you have seen The Crown on TV, as opposed to Churchill's reaction, which many of you know was to burn his portrait, which he felt made him look old and grumpy. That doesn't look old and grumpy, does it? My reaction is the opposite. I think this is a big improvement on the real thing. So I want to start by thanking the remarkable Daniel Green, for this truly lifelike portrait. You know, it's a little scary. I wore a different tie today, Amy said, don't look exactly like him. But I do want to, it does me great justice, and I salute your wonderful artistry.
My pleasure.
Chief Judge DeFiore insists that I make sure that the two of you connect. She's always thinking ahead like a good chief judge does, you know? Then, I want to thank my friend Sonia. And let me say, how many justices of the United States Supreme Court could you call by their first name in an audience like this and feel totally comfortable? This is the real thing. This is our Sonia. And what an honor it is for me and for this court, and for my dear friend, the Chief, to have Judge Sotomayor here with all of us today. And your remarks were beautiful, but what strikes me every time we see, don't we do run into each other, D.C. to New York, you know, on the subway, a kind of one town, really, is she is such a New York original. When she says she's home, she's home. And I think the bond that it exists, and it's such a perfect match for Sonia Sotomayor with the Court of Appeals of the State of New York, the, yes, professor, I'm not getting into the other issue, but the best high court in the country, state high court in the country, I am just so moved and so honored and so delighted that that she graces us with a presence today, and I will always, always treasure your being here at this event, which is so meaningful to me. So thank you, Sonia. I so appreciate it. It shows you can travel all over the world. You could also travel to Albany, right? Not so bad, West Catholic. Great, Albany, right? Okay. I also want to the Chief Judge, my dear friend Janet DeFiore, thank her so much for making this party, this event, for me. I am so proud of her. I am so proud to have her as my successor. I can't think of anyone in the state of New York that I'd rather have as the Chief Judge of this state and this state court system that I care so much about than my dear friend Janet. We've been through a lot together. We actually ran for office together. Both of us don't remember that, but we did, right? And it so pleases me that for every day since she's become the Chief Judge, she has made the ideal of equal justice her primary focus in each and every nook and cranny of this state. You know, a court system this sprawling, this big, can never be perfect. But what Janet has done is to ensure that we pursue excellence in every single courtroom with every single judge and every single staff person. So it gives me such a feeling of comfort to know that the court system, the New York State court system, is in such terrific hands. And I can't tell you how much joy I get by seeing this Chief Judge, Janet DeFiore, sitting in that seat underneath John Jay, and we'll be facing somebody else pretty soon. I don't know about that, but I love her, and I can't tell you the pleasure it gives me to have you as the Chief Judge. And the speakers today, let me just quickly just mention them, as each one of them is so important to me. First of all, Leo. The greatest period of my life was to work with Leo when he was the Chief Administrative Judge and I was the deputy. We had so much fun every day. We did the public's good, but we took ourselves seriously, but we laughed and laughed and laughed at the ironies of life and the different problems that you know you confront in the public world and tried to get things done. And the greatest part of it, as Sonia was saying about moving mountains, we had so much fun moving those mountains, didn't we, Leo? And so thank you, my dear friend, for being here. Jim Sandman, there is no subject more important to me. For me, it's my lifetime mission of ensuring equal justice and access to justice in our state and in our country. And there is no person that I would rather have speak about that issue than Jim Sandman. What Jim does every day is about the soul of our profession. He's someone who knows how to be in a successful law firm, the managing partner of Arnold & Porter, but what Jim does is goes to the heart of our profession. It is what we are all about, that everybody gets their day in court, regardless of how much money is in their pocket, what their station of life is, in life is, what their race, ethnicity. Jim gets it And I can assure you, Jim, that every person in this room is with you in the battle that you are facing today, where I think all of you know that the Office of Management and the budget in Washington has tried to zero out the Legal Services Corporation in its budget, and rest assured that that will not stand. We are right there with you, Jim. Professor Bonventri, I want to thank you not only for your lovely comments, but also for your study of the High Court's work. You know, it is so important to us. The Court strives to be that best court, best High Court in the entire nation. And you really do justice to the amount of time and energy. And you know, we bonded. We didn't really know each other, but I became the chief. But again, this question of the New York Court of Appeals and its place in the jurisprudence of our country is that we both feel so deeply about. We both agree that the law evolves through strong majorities and strong dissents, and that's what makes a high court great. And thank you, Vin, for your kindness to me and for your kindness to this court in helping us in this effort to be, again, what we are and what we should be, the best high court in the nation. Professor, thank you. And Jamie Wine, the head of global litigation at Latham & Watkins, my next door neighbor in New York City. Our offices are right next door to each other. I want to thank you and all of our colleagues at Latham, so many of them were here today, for the privilege of not only practicing law, getting to practice law at such a high level, but also the privilege of being with a law firm that understands that our profession is not being in a silo, that we're part of the world around us. And this is what the law is all about. This is what our profession is all about. And the firm has been so supportive of me, not only in the practice of law, but in the public work that I do. And whether it be access to justice or criminal justice, it is just, again, I'm so proud to be with a law firm like Latham that stands for something. And it's great to be successful, and we're very successful. But I came to this law firm because I believed it shared my values. And it's been a delight. And thank you, Jamie, for being here. And then my old pal, Mary McQueen. We were both a little younger, many years, as you said, a little younger when we started together on different ends of the country, but with the same love of the courts, the same passion about the courts. I think we both fell under the spell of this pursuing justice each and every day, the thousands of people who stream into the courts seeking that thing that's so hard. It's not concrete sometimes, but our job is to make it feel concrete, this idea of justice, that everyone, again, everyone gets justice. And Mary and I have again, been through so much together. And Mary represents to me the nobility of the state courts, the nobility of the judiciary. We have so many, our lifetime has been with so many dear friends, the chief justices around the country, the state court administrators. And I am so glad, Mary, so happy that you are at the helm of the National Center for State Courts, the voice of the chief justices around the country. And what a powerful and passionate voice. And thank you, Mary, for being here today. And to my colleagues, past and present, in the trial court, the appellate courts, and the high court, Thank you for the privilege of being able to serve with you. Certainly at the High Court here, in this beautiful courtroom, in this beautiful building, we often disagreed, but we are never disagreeable with each other. And that's what an appellate court, certainly the High Court of the state, is supposed to be. I'm so pleased to have seen the evolution of New York law upfront and personal over my 7 years as the chief here, as a presiding justice of the appellate division. There's such a rich history in this state and in this particular place. I just am in awe of being here. When I sat here every day for 7 years, you know, it was something almost inconceivable to me. I'm humbled to be with the John Jays and the Benjamin Nathan Cardozos and the Charlie Brightells and the Judith Kays. You know, what more could there be? Especially for someone 40-some-odd years ago who entered the court system in an entry-level position, who could never have imagined all of this. So on behalf of myself, my family, the beautiful Amy, my two children, Lindsay Russell, my daughter-in-law Jennifer, my brother Jay, my sister-in-law Judy, and all the other Lippmans who are floating around but couldn't necessarily be here today, I thank all of you for being here. I thank you for this day, which is absolutely one of the highlights, the absolute highlights of my life. So thank you so much.
So that concludes this afternoon's ceremony and portrait unveiling. On behalf of Judge Lippman and his family, I invite you all to join us for a reception in the attorney's library outside the courtroom. And I would like to acknowledge and express our appreciation to the Historical Society and the New York State Trial Lawyers Association for hosting this lovely reception that you're all invited to. Thank you, and thank you for being here.